the time up. It's time to go sit down again. We have to sit up there, that's where grandma is. And that's where May is. You have to sit with your baby sister. Okay, you sit here by yourself for a little while, and I'll come and get you.
Like that chair. I put something on the side. Good evening, everyone. My name is President Frank DeVore. I am the first counselor in the state presidency of the McLean, Virginia State. We want to welcome you to this Easter concert of the Washington, D.C. Temple Choir. To begin with, we're going to have an opening prayer, which is our practice to have prayer at these performances. Amelia Smith from Great Falls Ward in the McLean State will offer that prayer, and then we'll have some additional instruction before we begin.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank this wonderful day. We thank you that we're able to gather here on this Sabbath day and listen to the D.C. Temple Choir. We thank thee that we can hear the sacred music and help us to feel thy spirit tonight as we worship thee through song. And we thank thee for our very many blessings, and please bless the singers as well as the conductors and musicians tonight. We see these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. All right, well, it's now an opportunity to introduce the Washington, D.C. Temple Choir. The choir was founded in 1980. The Washington, D.C. Temple Choir is composed of over 80 singers from about 50 congregations of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints throughout the greater Washington area. The mission of the choir is to worship God, to testify of Him and His work through music, and to support the interfaith outreach of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. The choir's repertoire includes major choral works, hymns, spirituals, show tunes, Americana, and patriotic music. The choir has performed throughout the Washington, D.C. region and Mid-Atlantic states in houses of worship and other venues, including the White House, Constitutional Hall, Strathmore Hall, the Kennedy Center, Washington National Cathedral, Washington Hebrew Congregation, Washington Monument, Navy Memorial, Fort McHenry, and Andrews Air Force Base. We would especially like to recognize Kate Thurgood, the president of the choir, Gary B. Clawson, the principal music director, David J. Hardin, associate director, Kay Durr, principal accompanist, Tim Willis, assistant accompanist, and Nicole Papenbus, assistant accompanist. While this is an Easter time, an Easter season, we always want to remember the Savior and the wonderful gift it is of His. Not only His birth, but His resurrection and His atonement for us. I hope that you can hear through the music that we listen to today a testimony of the Savior, of the reality of His life and the reality of His atonement for us. Though this is a Sunday evening, we would invite you to feel free to applaud and the choir at different points throughout this. At the end of the performance, we will not have a closing prayer, but the choir will be doing something for us that will serve that purpose to be a benediction for us. We're grateful for your attendance here, and now turn the time over to the choir for the performance.
Good evening. My name is Kate Thurgood. I'm the choir president, and we would like to thank you all for coming out this evening to celebrate the beautiful Easter season with us. We would like to thank McLean State for hosting us this evening. It's great to be here. We are recording tonight and live streaming, so this will be on our YouTube channel, so you can watch it forever if you like what you hear. We'd like to remind you, since we are recording, to silence your cell phones, and if needed, small children, so we have the best recording possible. We will not be introducing each number tonight, so please, if you have not gotten a program, we do have plenty of programs for everyone, so you can reference that as to what song we're doing and who our soloists are. We also have in our program our upcoming performances, and we still have a very busy Easter season, so we encourage you to look up that and also see our June concerts coming up on June 1st and 2nd. So without further ado, I will turn the time over to our principal music conductor, Gary Clawson, for our opening number, and I will return a little later in the program to give a brief Easter message. But for now, sit back and relax and enjoy our program. Thank you.
Thank you.
In John 20, verses 11 through 16, we read, "But Mary stood without at the sepulchre weeping. And as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the sepulchre, and see a two angels in white sitting, the one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. And they saith unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? She saith unto them, Because they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they have laid him. And when she had thus said, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing, and knew not that it was Jesus. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing him to be the gardener, saith unto him, Sir, if thou hast borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus saith unto her, Mary. She turned herself and saith unto him, Rabboni, which is to say, Master. Jesus Christ is the Son of God, sent to earth to redeem us from sin and death. He willingly took on the role of our Savior. Jesus suffered for all of our sins as he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane and was hung on the cross to die. He gained a perfect divine understanding of everything you and I have ever experienced. The Savior's ultimate sacrifice for us all makes it possible for us to repent and be forgiven of our sins. Jesus Christ's victory over death through his resurrection makes it possible for all of us to live again, and we can look forward to living with God and our families for eternity. 24 years ago, in a First Presidency Christmas message, Gordon B. Hinckley said, "There would be no Christmas if there had not been Easter. The babe Jesus of Bethlehem would be but another baby without the redeeming Christ of Gethsemane and Calvary and the triumphant fact of the resurrection." In 1968, James A. Cullimore said, "Christmas is less a day of victory than Easter, for the story that begins then is incomplete until it is crowned by the announcement, the Lord is risen." Last Easter, Elder Gary B. Stevenson said, "Take Christmas away, and in biblical terms, you lose two chapters at the front of Matthew and Luke. Take Easter away, and you don't have a New Testament. You don't have Christianity." Then he asks, "Are we inadvertently shortchanging the true meaning of this holiday of Easter, so central to all believers in Jesus Christ? How do we model the teaching and celebration of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the Easter story, with the same balance, fullness, and rich tradition of the birth of Jesus Christ, the Christmas story?" We will close this spoken Easter message now with a powerful testimony given by Elder Bruce R. McConkie at Easter time in 1985. He was suffering from cancer at the time and only lived a couple of weeks after this address. These are his concluding remarks. "And now, as pertaining to Jesus Christ, I testify that he is the Son of the living God and was crucified for the sins of the world. He is our Lord, our God, and our King. This I know of myself, independent of any other person. I am one of his witnesses, and in a coming day, I shall feel the nail marks in his hands and in his feet, and shall wet his feet with my tears. But I shall not know any better then than I know now that he is God's Almighty Son, that he is our Savior and Redeemer, and that salvation comes in and through his atoning blood and in no other way." Brothers and sisters, let us all add our voices to those who joyfully proclaim this Easter season and always that he is risen.
Thank you. Thank you. choir's decided.